Hi, everyone. Welcome to day two of Civo Navigate. First of all, give me a show of hands. Who was here yesterday? Well, most people. Yeah. Did you have a good time?
Yeah, good.
Well, hopefully we've got a fun packed day for you today as well. And it sounds like only a few of you used the mechanical ball, but it was I was watching all that and it was great fun. And that's something that we always wanted to bring to our events is learning and innovation and things like that, but also hopefully people have fun. T-shirt cannons, I think Kieran needs to maybe retrain a bit there with the one stuck on the ceiling, but he did redeem himself on the last one, so we give him that. But super excited to be here. And I'm going to talk today a little bit about where we are right now in tech, but especially big tech, and more importantly, where I think we need to go in the future. But before we get into that, just a little bit about myself. This is actually my 25th year of running companies. I founded my first company back in 1999. It was a company called LCN.com, and it actually grew to become the fifth largest hosting company in the UK. It hosted about 400,000 domain names. It was more of like a GoDaddy-style company, if you like, the kind of starter websites and things. But I diversified into data centers in 2008, launching a data center company and built some data centers again in the UK. And in 2012, started putting fiber in the ground again across the UK. And then cybersecurity got involved in 2016. Cybersecurity company actually is a global company, operates in the US and the UK. And we launched defense.com, which you might have seen as one of the sponsors here today as well. If you haven't seen them, go check them out because it's an awesome SaaS product that we've launched. And then more recently, 2017, obviously launching Civo. And really that was set up to challenge the hyperscalers and think differently, which I'll come on to. But I'm going to start with a pretty big statement. The cloud is broken. The cloud is broken. Now, personally, I believe in the context of cloud computing and how we consume infrastructure, cloud infrastructure specifically. I'm not talking about, you know, iCloud or SaaS products, that kind of thing. I'm talking about cloud infrastructure. I believe that the cloud is currently broken. And I know that's a pretty big statement, and there's not too much context to that at the moment, but does anyone, maybe a show of hands, does anyone actually agree with that statement at all? Well, there's quite a few. More than I thought, actually, but I'm going to convince you anyway, but we'll get into that. So it looks about maybe 25%, maybe people would just put their hands up then. So I want to go back really and explain why I think this. So first of all, I'm going to show you a quote from Andy Jassy at reInvent back in 2012. And for those of you who don't know, Andy Jassy is the current CEO of Amazon Retail, the main business, but he was the previous CEO of AWS. And as we know, Amazon pretty much defined what we know as cloud computing back then. And back then, at reInvent, Andy Jassy said, the quote, customers love the fact in the cloud that they get to pay a lower variable expense than they can do on their own. He then went on to say, AWS is able to take its very large scale and pass on those savings to customers in form of lower prices. Now, what's super ironic, in the same speech, Andy Jassy talked about gross margins of old school tech companies working to 60 to 80% gross margins. But you can see on the quote here, he said, high margin businesses have been around forever and in lots of industries, obviously a very successful business model. It's just not ours, he said. It's not just ours. And it's hard to actually decipher what the Amazon gross margin is because they mix all their revenue into their retail business. But Microsoft do actually publish theirs, about 72%, and we can probably expect that it's similar range for AWS. In the last quarter results, they made $7 billion of profit in one quarter. So that doesn't sound to me like the low margin business that Andy Jassy sold to us back in 2012. And right now, we're seeing so much news and press around this of increasing prices, a few examples up on the screen, and companies struggling to control costs. You know, we're seeing obviously huge layoffs at the moment in tech sectors, but costs are going up with cloud providers. So it's technology chiefs struggling to wrangle with their cloud costs. Amazon now suffering. Their stock price is down as their high prices are now slowing their growth. And the nickel and diming that's mentioned, the lock-in that the hyperscale providers are now doing to their customers. This is a quote from The Guardian as well, which just demonstrates in the last year alone, the prices from the big tech companies have increased between 10 and 50% just in the last year. And there's more rises coming. Amazon just announced that IP addresses, they're going to charge for all the IP addresses that they never charged for before. And that's going to produce an extra billion of revenue for them in 1 year. This is a report from Flexera. And in the same report, it's about 750 enterprises that were, also small businesses and enterprises were surveyed. And last year in the same report, security was the number one challenge that faced companies. And this year, you can see 82% said managing cloud spend was the highest. And interestingly as well, you can see the lack of resources is in third place. And again, you're probably in a time where we're laying people off, but we're actually expecting people to do more with less. And then Civo, we actually carried out our own. This is actually hot off the press. This is going to be announced in the next day and be released to the press. But we've done our own cloud cost survey. And we found, and we surveyed about 500 companies, just over. And 64% of businesses said that they had seen a cloud cost increase over the last 12 months. 42% of businesses said they cannot easily predict their cloud bills. 57% of businesses have been forced to take action to reduce their cloud spend. And I think it's crazy that we actually have to employ, you know, very expensive consultants now to actually help reduce cloud bills. We have to have all this whole world of FinOps software now to help us reduce cloud bills. So something feels broken. And only a third of respondents felt that hyperscalers were good value for money. 52% of people said that the cloud had failed to live up to the promise of cost effectiveness. And even more crazy is 47% of businesses are considering moving away from cloud. And this is what's known as cloud repatriation. And it's not just us that found this. This is an IDC recent survey, and they actually found 71% of companies are looking to move all or some of their workloads that are currently on public clouds back to traditional IT private environments in the next 2 years. So why is this happening? It's because cloud has failed to live up to its original promise. The same promise that Andy Jassy back in 2012 at reInvent told us and promised us about lower cloud prices than you can do yourself. And then since then, we've seen this rapid price rise after price rise, nickeling and diming and locking customers into proprietary ecosystems. But it shouldn't have to be this way. I think it's ludicrous that we've got to this point where cloud is starting to get a really bad name. The benefits of cloud computing is clear for all us to see. The huge advantage is that, you know, years ago we had to, you know, place orders for servers, wait, you know, weeks to get those delivered, maybe months sometimes. We had to rack them up. We had to get all the cabling done. We had to, you know, install the systems and the operating systems and the cable or the storage, the networking, all those kind of things. And, you know, nowadays we can spin things up in an instant and with unlimited capacity and scale on demand. And I think that's the beauty of cloud, and the concept has huge benefits. But in my opinion, it's gone too far, and the perceived value of cloud is starting to diminish. So what is Civo doing about it? We believe in a cloud that is fair, equitable, and open, which stays true to the original promise of cloud by supporting business growth and not hindering companies through escalating costs, vendor lock-in, and other things that are taken from your control. How is Civo different, you might ask? Well, we believe we're reimagining cloud computing. We're lowering costs. On average, we're 60% lower cost than the hyperscalers. Our GPUs are a quarter of the cost of hyperscalers. But we believe in fair and predictable pricing, not all the surprise bills, all the surprise usage-based charges, egress fees that are massively inflated. Reduce complexity. As we said, people have laid lots of staff off. There's less people now to do more. So in terms of reducing the complexity, we've abstracted a lot of that away. And we give you same defaults, so you know, it reduces the amount of configuration options that you have to look after. We're supporting open standards. All of our hardware that we use is open compute hardware. We support the best of open source software, which takes away that vendor lock-in. And we believe in a world where people should be free to move, not because they feel trapped, into an ecosystem, into a proprietary ecosystem. They should be free to move and judge a company on quality of service, performance, reliability, and not because they've been feeling trapped. But I also believe in a much bigger purpose that is way more important than profit. I'll throw this term up on the screen. It's cool. Everyone's heard this. In shitification. It was actually the word of the year in 2023. And essentially, it's when an online platform becomes more monetized as it goes along, and less you're user-orientated the longer it exists. And it was coined by Cory Doctorow in November 2022, and he describes how platforms die. They are good to their users at the start, then they abuse their users to make things better for their business customers. Then finally, they abuse their business customers to claw back all the revenue for themselves, then eventually they die. And he talks about in history that this has happened time and time and time again over history, and companies push their users too far and eventually they leave. And I think this is starting to happen with some of the big tech companies. But I believe the world is changing, and it's changing fast. Before we go into that one, actually I got there. I have two kids, 6 and 9, and Isabella and Jack. They're gonna be really pleased that I mentioned their names in this talk. There's so much more educated on these societal issues that's happening around the world. And I'll just throw up some data on the screen here that says 27% of Gen Z will be expected to be in the workforce by 2025. That's a huge amount, and obviously that's gonna grow. And they're thinking differently. 77% of Gen Z's prioritize work-life balance. 37% of Gen Z's have sought out treatment for mental health issues. 72% of Gen Z's are extremely interested in environmental issues. And 44% said climate change is their greatest fear. 40% say they plan on leaving their job within the next 2 years. And of that 40%, 57% said that the reason they would be leaving is because the employers would not make an impact to positive societal change. So where does this leave big tech? Change is needed. Otherwise, these companies will die over time. Big tech needs to work for a wider societal impact and not just for shareholder profit. So you may ask what Civo's doing. Well, we believe in a sustainable future. Already you might have heard from some of the sessions before, we've invested with a company called Deep Green for our GPUs, where we're using the heat from GPUs to heat swimming pools. We've also invested in a company called Heater that's putting servers on the side of hot water tanks and giving that hot water back to people. We're championing open standards, which increases the interoperability and removes that vendor lock-in. We believe in fair pricing strategies, where we're open and honest about what the pricing is without the inflated egress fees. We include a lot of the cost in the packages that you buy. We're community focused. We do events like this all around the world. We sponsor meetups, we run local meetups. We've just launched a venue in London where we're supporting local meetups, non-for-profits to be as an event venue. We're looking to do similar things in Austin. We have a Slack channel with 30,000 people on it that we support in the community. We believe in reducing the pay gap between the lowest and higher earners in our business. And work-life balance, we believe, is super important. And we're a four-day-week company and have been for over 2 years now. You might think, well, how do we fix the servers and bits and bobs on the other days? But we obviously flex the hours between people. And we're just excited to announce we've launched the Civo Foundation. And this is kind of hot news off the press. And we'll be donating funds from Civo Business into the foundations to help with social change. And that's through the purpose of that is three main things. The first one is the advancement of skills through education, and that's helping disadvantaged people gain tech skills so they can further their own career. That's championing sustainable technologies and giving money to great projects that are champion sustainability. And driving the social change by recognizing the immense power that technology can provide and supporting initiatives that kind of transcend traditional boundaries and create a profound social impact. So wrapping up, I believe we have a responsibility to leave the world in a better place for future generations. And as I said, I now think the cloud is broken, or perhaps more specifically, big tech is broken. And I hope you found this talk interesting and inspires you to support change. Thank you.